Okay guys, let's start with the webinar today. So we are starting with the part four of the Genesys webinar on web reports. And today we will start with the following agenda. If you can see the particular agenda that we have. We will start with the report architecture, web report architectures of on the screen, like how people can use the various parts of the screen. So we have the home screen, we have the repository tab, and then we have the servers tab. So they have different functionalities. Most people are working on the report homepage. That is where you run the reports. But we also have the repository tab and the servers tab. We can just quickly go to one of the installations that will help understand what we are talking about. So let me quickly show you this. I hope my screen shared. I guess not. Okay, so you can see this, right? So we have the home tab, we have the repository tab, and we have the server tab. So these are the various tabs that we'll try and discuss in our session today. There is a thing called as parameters, which we use in the reports. It's basically an abstraction layer of how we can use this a certain feature in the report to do filtering and to do, you know, conditional formatting. So what is the scope we'll define and how you can use these parameters in for filtering and conditional formatting, that will touch base upon that. And a very important factor for, let's say, item based reports is we want to have something configurable with respect to what information do you want to see of the item. So do you want to see category 1? Do you want to see category 2? Do you want to see the barcode in your output? If yes or no, that will decide what the output will become, and that parameters can be used for a special report output, right? And then we have the filters. How are filters created and used in a report? And then of course there is some difference between, though they can be used closely with each other. So we will discuss some differences. So just to understand what can be done in a parameter, what can be done in a filter, what cannot be done in a parameter like that. Okay. So let's start off with the architecture. So as I just shown you the home screen, I mean the reports admin's home screen, right? So there's a home screen where you can do the web report designing. This is the place where you can do a scheduling of a report. So this is something that we will cover in a separate webinar topic. And then there's a various visualization and rendering that you can do with respect to, let's say you want to see the output in a PDF or an Excel. So all those things can be managed through the home tab, right? From report designing, report execution, scheduling, visualization, rendering, right? So all of this can be done on your home tab. Next is something that is not used very frequently. Probably it's done by the administrators of the reports. So this is something when you want to do, let's say a version update, and you want to use a lot of new reports that are there. You want to sync those reports in your particular environment. The most important part of the repository is to provide reports into folders that will be later used for access management, report management and report security, and of course the versioning of the reports. Then comes the server part, where we have the power to create the various parameters. We have the power to change a lot of settings. We can do the data object presentation layer created there. And then of course the folders that we created in the repository tab, that can be used for security management, role access management, that we can do the server through the server. So this is the main the web report architecture, as you can see. And of course this server page is where you can create the connection to the database or the underlying physical data objects that are there. So it could be a database, it could be a file system, be a file. So anything that is there you want to define, that you can do through the server page, right? So let's, since we have talked about the architecture, let's go into your home screen and we can see it over there, right? So if we go to the home screen, the network issue. Okay. Sometimes it takes some time to load. Let's refresh the page once. Okay, so here is the various folders that we are there. There are the various structuring of the reports that you can do on this particular home page. You can start creating a report, create advanced report, you create dashboard, you can create express views. And of course, you can do the designing of the report from here. Once a report is being created, you can go and do some changes on that particular report. From Genesys, we have the reports as system reports. So from here, you can do the various, you can just copy those, duplicate those reports, and you can create your own reports, right? Based on the same data source that is already exposed. So probably you can want to change the viewing of the report. Right? You have a different visualization, you can do that. So all those things can be done through your reports homepage, right? Then, of course, the main part of the homepage is to design the report as well. And then comes the repository page. So this is where we can, seems to be, okay. I'll just skip the repository tab and go to the server tab just for just to explain the server tab now. So in this particular tab, you have the various sources, data sources. You have the various objects. So basically the table and views that are used. There's something as joined. So this is someone who has knowledge on database will be more comfortable with. This is a tab where we, so this is data is where the database person will have more comfort in. Then there's someone as a report administrator in your team who should be able to understand and use the guidance provided and maybe change the settings over here. But I mean, it's best not to change the settings over here, but there is a provision you can do that, right? And then of course you will have someone as a report administrator who can create the various roles. So let's say you have a finance role where you want to provide only the finance reports to that particular finance team or the people, all the users having the finance role, so that you can do through this particular roles. And there are various extensions. This is like the most technical part where we have the various functions, aggregate functions that are there, all that are provided from Genesys. Of course, you can create your own from here. Of course, there's a function to create, add, any more filter functions, any more aggregate functions, any more server events that you want to create, right? But this can have an adverse effect on your overall system, this thing, performance. So this is something that we would suggest not to change much of this, right? The most activity should be on your roles. And if you are very conversant with database and data objects, then probably you can also start creating data objects over here. Custom SQL you can create. You can create from various sources. Like you've seen this particular example, there are various databases that you can connect to. So here is a connection to an Postgres system. Here is a connect to an MS SQL system. There's an SQLite system. And there's of course the Genesis, which is the default connecting to the Oracle system, right? So all of this can be done from a data sources and then onwards, right? So since our webinar today is mostly focused on parameters and filters, I'll start off with creating a parameter just to show how easy it is to create a parameter and what all things that are involved while creating a parameter, right? So if you just click on this particular create an add, you will see a new parameter tab, that is window that is created, right? So what are the things that you need to provide in a parameter? You need to create a name for the parameter. You need to select a type. So you have the various types of a parameter. So it could be a string, it could be a date, it could be an integer, which is a number basically, decimal for the ones with having decimal places. And then there's a Boolean for true and false. So you have to select the type. If you have a value that you have, that is predefined for the particular parameter, let's say you want to say my first month of the year. So you say it is April, or the usage is January. So you can create a function that will create a parameter which will say January always is the default value, right? You can keep a parameter hidden, or you can expose that to the home page while running the report. So that you can do through this hidden true or false. So if it is hidden true, that means it will never be prompted to the user. A user would not know that the report is, this particular parameter is being used in this particular report. So there will be no prompt to the user, right? And if it is false, then you need to provide a prompt to the user to say, okay, select the customer ID, select the vendor ID, select the site ID or the site you want to see the report for. So like that, I hope that most of you have used reports. So you would know what are the various prompts that are there. I will anyway go to one of the existing report and show what are the various prompts that are there, right? And then we have a parameter dropdown object. Now this is something that if you will use if you have multiple values and as your parameter dropdown. So if you want to select a list of sites from a list of sites, list of vendors, or list of sources, agents, whatever. So probably in that case, you need to create something for an SQL over here, right? So you need to know where my data sources are there. So for that, you need to select the particular data source. If it is from Genesis, if it is from Genesis PostgreSQL or whatever is there as your database data source. So, right. So that can be used for creating a drop-down list. So you will have to scroll through the various values that are there, right? So we'll go to the particular report and we will see how these reports are concerned. So you understand, right? So if you have some single values that you want to select, right? That can be done without this parameter drop-down object. Let me use a existing one. Let's say I take on the as on date parameter. So if you see this particular parameter, you see that the name has been provided as on, and the type is mentioned as date. There's no value that is pre-provided to this because this date changes every day. So today it is 12th May, yesterday would have been 11th May, and tomorrow it will be 13th May, right? So that is something that can be taken care through the server events. But for this particular parameter, it's already taken care from in Genesis, but this can be managed, right? The same functionality can be also achieved through a filter. We will show that in a different, later on. But just to show how to create a parameter, I've just opened this particular parameter. And you see that the name has been provided. There's a type that has been selected, right? There's a value that has not been provided here because that is something, it's a dynamic thing. Of course, it is not hidden. It is hidden will be false here because you want to show the user that as on, this report has been executed as on 12th May, this report has been executed as on 11th May, that you want to show the user. That is why it is not hidden. And then of course you will have to provide a prompt in case you want the user to select that particular date, change that particular date, right? So that is the update parameter. Let's take on another parameter where we say we take, let's say this is a basis parameter, it's using a string. And here, the name has been provided as basis, the type is a string. Of course, it is not hidden, you have provided the prompt. But additionally to that, if you see from the as-on parameter, you see there's some additional values here. That happens when you select particular, drop-down object. When you create a drop-down object, then you get this additional fields in your parameter. So if there is a value field that will be displayed, it will be a value field that will be selected. This is very important when you want to show a user something that they can use and want to pass the underlying code to the particular procedure, particular view for a better performance, right? Or you can also send the same value as well. That is not a problem. So if you see the particular SQL in this particular case, so I'm asking the user to select a daily or a monthly or a weekly or a quarterly value, but what I'm passing it to the underlying object, it's the corresponding value. So probably your database design is such that you will have these values that will be accepted, but for the user, you have to make it more, let's say, interactive or understandable, right? So they can select a daily, whereas it will go as a D to the underlying object. So this is something that can be used to the advanced, advanced user can only do this. I'm not expecting this to be done from every user of the web reports, but let's say someone with an advanced knowledge of web reports can do this, create their own, yeah, and use it for a report that they want to create or want to modify, right? And then similarly, we have something for numbers as well. So let's say, let me just search something for number. Let's say, okay, I think this is a Boolean one. No, it's not. Okay, this one is a number. It's a decimal rather. So if you want a certain parameter which will be promoted to the user saying that show me values which are greater than this particular value, I can specify this to be a 0.5. I can default this, right? So when the report gets executed, this will be defaulted to this particular value, and the user may stick to it or may change it. They can do anything, but this is the default value that will be used. So again, so whatever you select as a type will be used in the particular report for the execution and execution purposes basically. So now, since we have seen how the parameters are being created, we'll try to use that in one of the reports. And like I have been using in the previous webinars as well, we will stick to the goods received register report as an example, which was also used on my previous webinar, in case you have already attended that. Right, so right. So if you see this particular section, you will see these are the various parameters that are there. Okay, one way to distinguish what a parameter looks like and what how to distinguish a parameter is, if you see an @ symbol before and after a particular phrase, then you have to understand that's a particular word. So that particular word is a parameter. So if you have seen that particular example, let's say if you want to use the as on date, right? So I'm just making some changes in the existing report. This is how you can create it. You have a formula editor. So every report has this. You have to select the cell. You can go to the formula editor here, right? And then you can create a parameter. I mean, rather not create a parameter, use a parameter. So if I use the as on in my report, I'm not doing anything on this particular report. I'm just executing this to show the parameter on your screen. So when I run this report, I've used this particular parameter in my report. I just run the particular report. So you see this as on data selected. And since today is 12th of May, it was automatically selecting that particular date. So date is something that is very often used in most of the reports. In most of our reports, it's like the from date and to date. So from date is the first of the financial year till to date. I mean, today's date. And also as on will be something with today's date in most cases, but of course there's a provision to change that. Right. So what we will do is, we will not try and create too many new report because that will take more time. What I'm going to do is I'm going to edit a existing report to show how parameters can be used. Right. Let's start with the basic one. Right. So basic here we have information with respect to. Let me just run this report once, and then we can show how what we can do with the parameters. So we have the dates, date range that has been selected. We have the division, section, and department. Right now, I will not select any of it. Of course, there is a site name. And then we have the, there's something called the minimum delivery quantity. There's something, a number you can provide here. Okay. So since these parameters, division, section, department, site name are, you know, string parameters. So, and also they have the information that is coming from the database. So if you see this, the dropdown that has been selected. So you have the dropdown of the various divisions that are there in this particular environment. Right. So if I select all, then I can select the corresponding sections for it. Right. Let me just select all over here as well. And if you don't select any department as well, that will also act as all. Right. And if I don't select a site as well, then it will also act as all. Right. So that you can do while executing the report. You don't have to select anything, right? So that will make sure that nothing, I mean, all of your data is selected. But as a good practice, it's a good practice, it's to keep select the all, because what happens in the first execution gets stored and it gets repeated in the next execution. So if you select the particular value, then that will be used in the next execution, right? So if I just run this report, I didn't select the minimum delivery quantity field. I kept it as it is, which will again mean that all of my delivery quantity will be showed. Right now, you see there's a supplier selection here. Now, this is a filter. First tab, which we were seeing was as a parameter. Basically, you would not always need to have both parameter and filters, yeah. But there will be certain scenarios where you would need parameters as well as filters to be there in part of as part of your report. But that would be a lesser, I mean, less frequent kind of a thing. Okay. So if you don't select again anything here, it will mean that all of my data will be shown. So you press OK, and then you see the report output. Right. So unfortunately, there's not much data in this particular date range, but you see that I have my GRC information and I have my division, section, group information, and then I have the item information. right? So probably since we the item name is shown with the barcode over here, let me just try and use that particular filters which this is a particular event that has to be included while you want to create the dynamic item name kind of. So let's not use the ones that are already being used. So let me create let's invoke the parameters that is required. So we'll select is category 1. Okay, then we use is category 2. You can just type it, it gets auto populated in most cases, right? So you just have to go to the formula editor, click on that. As soon as you type, it gets auto-populated. But then you need to know the list of parameters that are there. So yes, of course, this documentation is also available from Genesys. We will share that at the end of this webinar. And I just selected 4 categories here and I'll just run this report. So probably I want information with respect to only from my first 4 categories in your item information, right? So if I now select run this report, you would have 4 more parameters, rather 5 more parameters in your execution window. And all of them are defaulted to no. So do you want to show your barcode? So this is something that was there as part of the desktop version as well. So if you want to show the barcode, let's say I want to show the barcode, I select that to be an yes. And I don't want the others to be selected. I don't change them, right? So if I now execute this particular report, just run this again, 1 second. So if you don't select, sometimes some junk value also gets populated here. This is due to some caching that may happen time from time to time. So let me select all here. Right, and I want to select the barcode to be as a yes. Okay, there seems to be some issue here. Okay, let me take all the categories once. there's some issue with the network here. Let me just reload this. Give me a second, sir. I'll just stop the presentation just a second, just to see what's wrong here. Oh, okay. So I was trying to understand what went wrong here. Why is it not saving the report? I'll just quickly check this particular report. Okay, there seems to be some error that is happening. Okay, let's move on and let's just show some other parameter features. Let me just execute one last time and try to understand what's wrong here. And then we can probably move on to the other parameter features that are there. So in this particular example, what the basic expectation is, this item information should be as per the selection. So if you have selected barcode to be shown, so it will only show the barcode here rather than showing the item name, which is showing as Adana, right? So this is something that should change based on your selection of barcode or is category 1, 2, 3, 4. That needs to be checked. Maybe there's some issue here. Okay, so, but apart from this particular feature of parameter, you can do other things as well. So let's say you don't want to show in this particular information, you see there's the GRC level information and also you have the item level information. Let's say you don't want to show the item level information. You can use parameters to do that as well. So if you there's a parameter called a show detail. Let me just use that here. Right. So details. Right. And what will be the value for show details? It will select as yes or no. Right. Just run this report once.
Hi, Kuntal, I'm sorry I'm interrupting, but I think some of our guests are unable to see your screens. So can everybody type just yes if they can see the screen and no if they can if they cannot see the screen?
Actually, if other attendees can tell.
No. Should I just share? Reshare that?
Yeah, you can probably restart the screen share. Then we can see.
Is it visible now?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay. Yeah, I was saying that just to repeat the point, if you want to see the output, probably don't want to see the detailed information of a report, that you can do. So there's a option called a show detailed report, yes or no. It's by default selecting as no. So what will happen if you select this particular value? I mean, this particular parameter, right? So that you can do. You can do a conditional formatting. So this is something that has been discussed in previous webinars as well. So just show this with respect to a parameter now. So you can do a conditional formatting of a cell, in this particular case, a row, where you say you suppress the entire row if your value selected is, if your show detail parameter is no. So if your show detail parameter says its value is no, so you don't want to show this particular row, you'll suppress the entire row. So that particular information will not show in your report output, right? So just run this report again. Using this particular conditional formatting where I say detail show detail should not, I mean, we don't want to see the details of this particular item information. We just want to see the header level information. So if you do that, so you need to select the particular parameter value as no, then it will suppress the particular, not see that in the report output. So I should take a larger date range, right? So that will, okay. Now, since this is also related to item, probably what I can do is, I can quickly take the formatting from here and suppress this as well. This is basically the way to copy the formatting from one cell to another. You can use this brush option, format in brush. So what this will do is, it will copy the formatting from this particular cell to another cell, right? And let me just take this data from a different, I mean, a larger date range. probably then probably this will make sense. What is the effect of this? So information will be more concise and the viewing will be also better. So let's say I take the from 2020, 1st April 2020 till now, with the detail as no. Right. So you have, okay, so this particular report is doing information provided by supplier wise. So this supplier has in this date range provided for good receipts. So this way it is providing all my information in a single page, right? So when you take a printout of this or export that in Excel, the information will be much clearer. Now, same thing if you want to show with a detailed information. So your same report can work as like a summary information and a detailed information, right? So this is when you select a value as no, this is giving you a summary information. Now the same thing, I find I want to select as yes. So I say the show detail report as yes as well here. So I want to see the item information, item level information I want to see. So if I select that, the same report gets, now it's like more than 3 pages like the output. Now all the information is coming in this particular report. So you have the item information that is being presented in this particular report. So this becomes a larger report, and based on your necessity, if you want to see the information like this, you can of course select to this to be as yes or no. So the basic objective here is I'm using a parameter to select, give the user the opportunity to see a summarized information or a detailed information. So this is how you can use a parameter for conditional formatting, and this will help you reduce your data output on the screen, or it will give you better viewing purpose as well. Now, had you selected this, can the same thing be done through a filter? No, filter is basically to reduce the filter value. I mean, the number of records that you want to show. So had I as you see this particular output, had I a filter for a supplier ANB venture, then only I will get the information for this. The summary information that will depend on my parameter. This is like when we come to the parameter and filter differences, this is something that you need to know. So that this will in turn drive your choice for, let's say you want to use a parameter or you want to use a filter, right? And there is a few things that will happen for now. Moving on to the filter, actually. So if in this particular report as well, you saw that there's some filters that are there. So how do you know, how to see the filters? There's an option in the report designer where you can go to the report options and you go to the filter. Most of the times you would see that a parameter is used with the filter. So if you see this particular case, you can see that my filter has been used with the parameter. My site code is provided with the site name, right? However, my supplier name is something that is also a prompted, right? So most of the filters, if they are prompted, will be showing to the user. Similar to your parameters, which is prompted to the user, a filter can be also prompted to the user. Now, what can happen with the filter? There could be multiple things that can be done with the filter. So this will look like it is a more powerful tool, right? So you can do an equal to, you can do a not equal to. There are various set of operations that you can do. You can do a between, you can do select multi, do a multi-select through the option called as is one of, right? So you can select, let's say you want to select AB ventures that you can do. You can, you want to do a multi-select on the barcode, you can do that. So all of that things you can do from your screen, right? So you can, well, it's not showing right now because it's right at the bottom. If I take it to the top, you will be able to see this. Right, so these are the various barcodes you want to select. You want to select 10 barcodes that you want to see. And let's say you don't know what the full name of the barcode is, you can just type in here, let's say. Right, and click on the drop down. So you get the ones with the ABHR bundle. So since you didn't know the full name, you can just type in the keyword and we'll do a string search and get you the barcode information. Similarly for supplier, whatever fields that are there, if you don't know what the full name is, or you probably don't want to scroll through the entire list of names, you can do that search over here. So in my example, it was ventures, right? If I want to just select venture and click on the drop down, it gets it's okay. So you have to bear in mind one thing, that you have to select the contains option from here. So with, if it is a venture, starting with venture, then it will fetch the data. Otherwise, if it is the in between part, then you'll have to select a contains here. Now if I click on the drop down, I will get A and B venture. Now I can select that. Right, I can do multi select. I can select, what are the other name that I can select? Let's say Adina Dostar. Okay, select that. Gets populated. So I can do this, and then when I run this report, I can get only information with respect to just this two suppliers. So filter provides me an option to do multi selection. Whereas in parameter, you can only select only one value, right? So you can only see with respect to one site or one division, one section like that. Or if you want to see for all of them, you will have to select the all option or keep it blank, right? So now if I run this report, you will see information with respect to just the two suppliers, Adinath and ABNV Ventures, right? Okay, there's a barcode selection also that is there. Probably I need to remove that. Let me run this again. Yeah, this is fine. But barcode, we have selected a few values which we don't know. Since I don't know which barcode is been used in this particular suppliers, I will not select any of it, which will mean I will get me all my barcodes. Right? So this information is now with respect to, I thought it would give me two, unfortunately just showing us one. Okay, so at least I have one here and it has been selected, right? So what else can be done through the filters? Let me just show you that as well. So if I don't prompt a filter, it will not ask the user. So if you see in this particular section, I have so many filters, IDM site, receive date, right? That is not prompted to the user, but there is, you can do things that are, I mean, if you want to keep it hidden from the user's perspective, you can do that. You can also do, as you write in SQL, you want to write an OR condition or AND condition, that also can be also done through this. So most of the filters are in conjunction with an AND operation, but let's say you want to select this site or that site that you want to select, right? Or this date range or another date range that you want to select, you can do that through this with the OR conjunction, right? So again, this, if you how would you know if it's the filter is working properly or not? The bottom part is where you see what the condition is getting formed, right? So my supplier name is one of but this values, right? And my owner site code is the one for the from the parameter. And my GRC receive date is between my date from parameter and the date to parameter, and my division is between is equal to my division, right? So all this, whatever you have created over here as a filter, you can see this here, right? So let's say I want to select created on, and I want to, from the above part, we want to keep it as OR. So the last query and the next condition, you have created on condition, It's I selected to be is between yesterday and today. Okay, there is something called a date filter function. You can use this, and this could be very useful for report execution, especially when it comes to scheduling. So what I have done rather is from today to tomorrow, what has been created. It's not logical though. Let me just give you yesterday and today. So all those that GRCs that are created on this particular date range, yes, between yesterday and today, I will get them, and others things that are there from whatever criteria that I have selected earlier will be getting. So this is an OR condition. This will make sure that all of my information that is created yesterday and today will also show in this particular report. So like we do in a database or in writing an SQL, things that you want to do through a database to fetch the information, you know, most of the things can be done through this tool, and this can be visually, you can manage that. So you want to prompt this, you can prompt that. So in that case, you can change the particular filter. So what will happen if you make this prompt? This will make sure that, you want to select from a particular different date, you can do that. But if you don't do a prompt, when the report gets executed, it will always be values that have been saved here. So today it is 11th and 12th. When the report gets executed on 13th, this will be 12th and 13th. That is the specialty of date filter function. It will always, with respect to what the parameter is, what the date filter function is, it will change dynamically. Tomorrow this date will be 12th, and tomorrow this date will be 13th. Since yesterday was 12th, with respect to tomorrow. I hope that's not very confusing, right? So it will basically change dynamically. That's what I'm trying to say. So that again is a advantage of filter, right? Now, since we have discussed the two types, right? Again, this particular date filter function you can also use in the parameter as well, right? So you can select this and this, and just because of caching, this will be there in this particular report. But otherwise, if you just log out and log in, this will, that values will again be defaulted to that 1st of April 2021 to today, right? So this will not stick for parameters. It will not stick, whereas for filters, it will stick to the report. It will always be there in the report, right? So again, that's a difference. So going back to the PPT, if I can go back to the PPT, and hope it's now visible as well, right? So I will just go through the various differences between the parameters and filters. So parameter, you can do a single selection value, and you can do a default value that you can always keep it in the filter. Of course, the same can be achieved in a filter as well. But on top of that, there's no restriction to keep it as a single value. You can do a multiple value as well for the filters. Parameters can be used for conditional formatting. Filters can only be used to filter the number of rows. As I explained earlier, you can only use this show detail parameter to, you know, hide the detail section of the reports. But using a filter, you cannot do till a certain version of Genesis Web Reports. Going forward, this will also be available from the filters aspect, but currently it's not available, right? Filters can be hidden so that, sorry, parameters can be hidden, right? So I don't want to show it to this particular user, that particular parameter, because I don't want the user to select anything or change anything, right? That can also be done. If you see this particular report design, if you go to the filters, you would see something as the ADM OU code. This is the con OU code. This is not getting prompted on the user screen because this is a hidden parameter, right? And this is not something the user, if you want to restrict the user with respect to particular con OU, I mean, organization unit, that the user can force to the user to change. This will always be the connected site that is there and the connected OU that is there. So that will be defaulted to that particular report execution as well. So that is tenancy feature or a filtering feature that you make sure that this will not be shown to the users. So this is the parameters. That's the advantage of the parameters. Filters also can be prompted to be, can be prompted off. So the user would not know what particular value that is there, but while creating the report, while changing the report, if there are any filters that are there, then that can also be taken care of. I mean, that can be removed. Another difference is parameter values can be passed to filters. Of course, parameter in itself can be used for mainly two purposes, for conditional formatting and passing on to the filters for doing some filtration of data, where you don't want to provide the complexity of the filtering functions to the user. The user wants to select the value and they want to filter the data, right? Parameters are by default not dependent, whereas filters are dependent by nature. So if you remember, I was trying to get the barcode information, supply information was not showing in that particular drop-down, just showing a tick there. Now, why is that? Because since I did not select anything on top of it, right? And there was a parameter involved, since it was not getting a value, it was showing me as a blank value. So what I did was I moved that particular barcode information to the top, and that is when I got to see the drop-down. Now, that is because filters are dependent in nature, and that is not getting shown when the parameter was at the bottom of the filter this thing list. When I moved to the top, it started showing me the values. So that is what it is. Filters are dependent in nature. Parameter shows only one value and can return same value to the corresponding code value to the report. Now, as I was saying, that since you want to show the customer name, whereas you want to provide the customer SLID to the backend part or the view part. Now, why this is necessary? Because sometimes there are a lot of duplicates with respect to the customer name, supplier name, supplier name or the site name, which may cause some confusion, right? So that is where you want to select one value and return one value, right? So in that cases, you would provide a separate value to the backend engine, right? Whereas you can also do the same. You can select the customer name and provide the same to the customer and the backend system as well. So in case where there are more than one suppliers or more than one site with the same name, you will get the information for both of the sites, since you've selected the name and passed on to the name, and both of the details have the same site name. And for filters, it will always be showing whatever value you are selecting, it will go back to the backend. So the second part of the parameter is always true for filter. Whereas parameter, it can be different as well, right? Parameters can be defined globally, that is for all the reports. Because you create an as-on filter, parameter, that will be used in all of my reports. I can use that, right? Whereas filter, when you create a report, only then you come to work with the filter. The filters are very specific to that particular report. So, yeah. So that was the webinar today, where we just worked upon the various architectural modules. We just showed them what they are and how they function. We talked about the parameters, defined the scope for the parameters, used them in conditional formatting and filtering. And then we tried to create a report with the is category 1, 2, 6 and is barcode. Unfortunately, that did not work, but yes, that will work in your generic reporting. You should be able to see that. If you create a duplicate for the goods received report, goods register report, duplicate that, and you will see that particular parameters being used, and that should function properly there. We discussed what are the filters that are there, how the filters are created and used in a report, and then we ended up with the differences between the parameters and filters. And that was it for today's webinar. Thank you, everybody. So I just stopped my sharing my screen, and hopefully we have learned something from this today's webinar. And probably now it's time for the Q&A session. So Namit, if you want to add something before we can start with the Q&A.
No, it's fine. It's fine. I think we are having a good session for this report. Learning and I think it's most advanced part actually we have discussed in the report this webinar series. Hope everybody has gone through our earlier webinar, even if not, maybe the recording of that webinar would help them. And Kuntal, I think we should can move to this Q&A session. And what I have seen in the Q&A session, it's mostly are very specific cases. So if we just one by one go through, and I think maximum we can part we can request them to for support ticket and to get resolved for that, because whatever I have understood from the Q&A questions which we have got. Maximums are basically report specific. So if you just go through the individual, then I think it would be better that to take it.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Navin. So yeah. If I can just quickly go through this, I'll just quickly go through that and I'll just respond to, it will be a specific response or it will be a generic response. So Mr. Ravi Mishra, well, it started at the starting of this webinar, he asked, whenever I use two sortings, you mean sortings in one web report, second sorting not work properly. Brand-wise sale detail report, I want to sort two things in report, brand-wise net amount in descending order. This should not be the case. Your sorting should work properly.
I think this
is a specific issue. So this can be taken as part of like a support ticket, but it's a normal thing. You should be able to do the sorting based on your brand and your net amount.
Any level, actually, we can do the sorting for not
a one. So whatever you selected in your report design, you should be able to do that.
Yeah. If anything, you think that there's a need some hands-on training on that. So. With your format or with your report, which you have prepared and tried to prepare, just log a support ticket so that our team can just give you a hands-on training on that. And regarding, I think Kuntal, itemized GST report not generated in cross-tab format. I think this is also specific. It's from Pavan, Mr. Pavan Rai.
Yeah, just responding to Mr. Ravi. You can just take that up.
Yeah. And this itemized GST report not generated in cross-tab format, it seems that you have a specified format in your mind and you just to land up with that particular format. So I would suggest here also that if you just try to prepare up to the level which you can and just log a ticket so that our team will guide you. If there is any, it may be possible that the format which you have in your mind that might be limitations or something. So that will be hands-on specific case. We can definitely guide you. So I would request to just log a support ticket with your format and with your that report which you have tried to prepare.
And Mr. Pawan, just to add on top of what Navendu said, there is also a earlier webinar for cross-tab report that we did back in, I think, October, November, December, sometime in that range. So probably you can get in touch and get that particular webinars. You can probably go and check that as well. So how
that video you can just check.
Yeah.
Even for before coming up with the support team. I think Kuntal, this Mr. Milind Ajgawankar
as yes.
Yeah, please share demo of how to can filter the finance. I think we can show one that voucher report that we have, and there is a consider AP voucher, consider general voucher, there's a LOB filter is there. So is it possible to show that
report? Sure.
I think it would be better.
Yeah, since I did not get a chance to read that, you can just quickly guide me through that.
Yeah.
So if you go to, let's say, which report? AP voucher.
Yeah, it's a voucher register. There's a just write down the voucher. Yeah, let's go to the register. No, it's a document.
Voucher register, is it?
Yeah, just finance register. Go to the finance register that folder. Yeah, here the vouchers one report is there.
Payment register, did it?
No, it's not payment register. I think it is. Payment voucher, actually payment receipt and general voucher. There is a reporter there. I think it's maybe. Okay, just go with that other one. Let me check here and I'll just.
Okay. And this finance related filter like voucher ARP GV amount wise and voucher number wise. So you're saying there's a report you want on a voucher related information. Which are AP, ARAP, GB amount wise. Okay. Again, this is something that is specific. Okay. Vendor outstanding report also showing, not showing correct data. Sometime it's showing no data found. Vendor outstanding, as in.
I think customer vendor outstanding that.
Aging.
I think. Yeah, Mr. Dinesh, is it an aging report you are talking about, or that's a bill-wise outstanding report, analysis report that you are talking about? If you just can put, just comment here.
Vendor outstanding. Okay, this is the name. So you're saying sometimes sometimes not showing. You'll have to then check why it is not showing sometimes.
Yeah, that's I think if just for any such specific issues for any report, if you find that this report is not running properly or you have a data error, just immediately log our support ticket and the team will definitely get back to you within stipulated time.
Pawan has another point with respect to cross-tab report also required in sale and stock report.
Yeah, sale and stock, if you have, we have sale and stock report for retail sale and stock report. That sometimes it's difficult to manage in the cross-tab for different, because cross-tab, what would be there in the cross-tab format, what would be there in the column. So that's something very much customizable option that depending on the business needs. So different businesses are looking for different categories in their cross-tab. So might be we'll not come up with any specific cross-tab kind of report, but definitely we have already retail sales stock report where we can find that the sale and stock a particular period. Even the report is considered in such a logic that if a sale is not there, if you want, you can put the stock even also. If there's a sales, stock is zero, that will show. So there's a multiple combinations over there which we have addressed of that retail sales stock report. That's basically considering the retail part. It's a post sales and stock. So maybe we will be come up later for the sales in each level. So that's something. And if you have any specific format that you feel that you need that, you can just log a ticket. If we come up, if we will analyze and if it's found that it's not a generically possible, definitely we, our custom delivery team will get back to you and they will.
Can we ask to log this thing, care? Or...
Yeah, actually that care portal tickets, I'm suggesting that only that care portal, if a support portal ticket, they can log. And if we will analyze and if it's fine that the report is quite generic and that can be addressed for different other customers also. So definitely we'll look into that, and we'll get, incorporate in our later future and future releases. But if it's some specific requirement, then we'll definitely move this ticket to our custom delivery team so that they can give a specified solutions for you through this. And
we are done then.
Regarding that voucher, then if you have in mind, just log a ticket. So we'll one will show you the reports, and if the format is not properly available in a system that you are thinking of, then we'll definitely analyze on that, and we'll get back to you on that.
All right. So I hope all the questions were cleared. And for the specific ones, as Kuntal said, this can be, you can bring it up with your account managers or raise the ticket. And